Okay, let's get started for the evening. Before we begin officially, Dr. Delaney's asked that we announce Desert Tortoise surveying and monitoring that's happening March 21st, which is exactly tomorrow.
In this room.
And you're going to be out on the Desert Tortoise Preserve that's here at the college, right? Come learn about the Desert Tortoise Preserve here at the college. Thanks very much, Paul. So thanks everybody for coming. Thanks very much to the Joshua Tree National Park Association and to the Copper Mountain College for hosting the event. We're going to be talking tonight about how to engage a new generation of park stewards. And for those of you who don't know, there are a few of us new generation of park stewards in the room with you tonight that Cindy's going to be talking about, I think maybe with some slides in her presentation. I've been forewarned at least. I wanted to just talk about the Joshua Tree National Park Association for a moment before we really get into the speakers. The Park Association has been supporting the operations of the National Park with scientific research, preservation, and education since 1962. It's the park's primary nonprofit partner. They operate four visitor center bookstores that are often the first contact that visitors to the park have when visiting Joshua Tree. Also, as many of you know, they offer a field institute, the Desert Institute, which they host, that offers field trips in the park all about the natural history for adults and kids. And they host the Black Rock Lecture Series, which started out in Joshua Tree National Park at Black Rock, but as you can see, it's outgrown the little place there, Black Rock. But you can't get away from your roots. The association also helps raise funds for the park through public events and a membership program. And if any of you are not members of the association, which I hope you all are, you can talk to folks over at the association. There's Meg in the back. Hi, Meg. To get signed up for a membership. There's a Joshua Tree Art Festival, the annual art festival that supports the association at the 29 Palms Art Gallery on Easter weekend. So April 3rd, 4th, and 5th, head on out to the 29 Palms Art Gallery to help support the association. I'd like to thank a few people in particular. Thanks Jeff Cummings, who's the interim president of Copper Mountain College. And then would the members of the board of the association that are here with us tonight stand up? Lorraine, I know you're here. And Karen Tracy. Some of the partners that we have here tonight, obviously Joshua Tree National Park is here. The High Desert Nature Museum. When's your Earth Day Festival? April 18th is the Earth Day Festival this year, and cards are on the table to take. There's also, I think there's a table back there for the Morongo Basin Conservation Association. Yay! And of course, the National Park Association. So with that, I'd like to just dive into tonight's program. I want to just say a few words about outdoor education and how it's had an influence on me. I grew up here in Joshua Tree, and I like to think that every bad decision that we make as a culture is made because of a lack of context, and that by teaching about the natural world, we're helping to ensure that the next generation has a context with which to make good decisions about anything from the drinking water here in the basin, to our night skies, to taking care of the national park, which we all know is facing a variety of different challenges right now. Our first speaker tonight is an education specialist at the Living Desert, which I'm sure you're all very familiar with the Living Desert. Romina Arce runs the Living Desert Zootine program. And Romina has had a pretty colorful background. She grew up in Northern California. She's been part of the Marines. She's actually worked in a butcher shop in Anza and lived in Mountain Center, where she met Karen Salzman, who is the CEO of the Living Desert. and which is how she got involved with the Living Desert Zoo down in Palm Desert. So without further ado, Romina, do you want to join us up here on the podium, and we'll let you get started.
Well, good evening. It's such a great honor to be here and be able to share something that's very important to me, the Living Deserts Zoo Teen Program.
Can you put the mic to your mouth?
Is that better?
Yes.
Okay. So it's an honor to be here to speak with you tonight about the Living Deserts Zoo Teen Program. The kids are fantastic. And when I joined the program in 2009, the program was good, but it needed some tweaks. So that's what this is about today, how we took that program from good to great by focusing on the teens themselves. So just a little agenda. I'm going to talk about these four main points. What was a zoo teen? The big questions that we had to consider, the zoo teen experience now, and what a zoo teen is today from the perspective of a zoo teen. So, what was a zoo teen then? All zoo teens are high school students, and a lot of people, they feel that volunteering, those volunteers are free. Well, that honeymoon idea is over when you realize that they take a lot of time, a lot of energy, and when that manifests itself, that ends up making them like a ball and chain to the organization, and sometimes, and mostly, to the coordinator if they really don't have the right perspective. Now, this is what was being manifested basically at the Living Desert when I took over the program. That coordinator was very overwhelmed by this program. Working with high school students, I'm sure you know, if you do work with them, that they need attention. They need to be stimulated, appreciated. They need to be benefited. If they're not, then how are they supposed to be their best? How are they even supposed to know what their best is? Well, if you don't give 100% to the zoo teens and what they need, they're not going to give 100%. And if they're not giving 100%, our guests are getting a mediocre experience, making our facility a mediocre facility. And that ends up in an attendance depression in this experience economy. People want experiences. They're not looking for something to just go and do. So that's the reality of it. We had to focus on the teens. So that brings us to the big questions. Could the program be better? What did the teens get out of the volunteering? Can we attract quality, sustainable participants? And how, when, can we interact and train them to an optimal level that they will actually enjoy themselves and the guests will enjoy themselves? So this brings us to question number one. Could the program be better for all stakeholders? Well, who are the stakeholders? Well, Living Desert's the first stakeholder. If Living Desert benefits from the program, it's going to have to get a benefit from the guest. So Living Desert's got to go last, but Living Desert was first, as you see in my list. Living Desert was first. That wasn't working. The guest was second. Well, the guest isn't going to benefit if we don't focus on the teens, because the guests need a good experience. If they're not getting a good experience, then why are they coming, right? So it was the zoo team. We found that the zoo teen can benefit from the program for volunteering and experience on their resumes and applications, but was that it? Was that all that we could offer them? I didn't think so. So it took a shift of focus. The zoo teens needed to be first. Then the Living Desert was last, and the guest falls into the middle perfectly, because the zoo teens are taken care of, the guests get a good experience, the Living Desert benefits. It worked really well. So, as the coordinator, this is what we did. Benefits for the teens. That was the first step. The bottom line, experience is limited to what we're willing to offer them. What did we offer them then? Basic public speaking and limited science experience. What do we offer them today? We offer them interpretive training, and significant interpretive training. We offer them personal growth, animal handling opportunities, leadership opportunities. We even offer them advanced interpretive training. So it's not a minimal. They can continue all the way through, which you'll see later when I outline it. With the shift in focus, we realized that when you nurture the zoo teen, you nurture the zoo, you nurture the guest. With the quality training and growth opportunities, the students will reach for them. I don't know about any of you, but if you don't give youth something to reach for, they're not going to reach. They need something to reach for. And that's what we did. We gave them opportunities to reach. And that brings us to the next one. So we figured out we needed to give them something to work for, not just let them come in and talk to people and be boring. They had to have something to work for. Now, how do we attract those quality, sustainable students that will work for that? The answer to this, whether we could do it, was yes, but we had to create those quality opportunities first. So we went through, we found out from a survey what were teens looking for. They were looking for things to put on their applications and their resumes that were not just, yes, I volunteered. They wanted something with depth. We found that in interpretive training through the National Association of Interpretation, the Certified Interpretive Guide Program. So what has happened since then? Our 15 students max in 2009 with a low retention turned into 30 to 50 in over just little over a year, where I actually have a waiting list of students trying to get into the program. In terms of sustainability, most of our teens stay the entire high school term, and many go to college, but some stay, they become volunteers, docents, and even staff. So how do we do this? This is the meat. This is what you're waiting for. After experiencing the training of a lifetime, it occurred to me what I needed to do. The word was in the question, interact. The teens needed to have interactive training, and I had just experienced that with my certified interpretive guide training. The National Association's definition of interpretation is that it be a mission-based communication process that forges emotional and intellectual connections between the interests of the audience and the meanings inherent in the resource. Were we doing that when they were just talking to people? No, we were not. They were just an interaction. We needed to connect the zoo team so that the zoo team would understand the importance of why they were there. They were there to support the mission, to teach desert conservation through preservation, education, and appreciation. Most of them had no idea we even had a mission. So, what did we do? We immediately input this CIG into our training. Soon after, we became interpretive trainers so that we could offer it to them at a discounted rate. This means that our guests are given an interpretive experience at a professional level, and now our teens have a credential, a professional adult level credential, to add to their experience as well as skills and ability. The teens have to listen to lectures all day, and they're given rules every time they turn around. This training is nothing like that. This is very interactive, and it teaches them to be interactive, to go out into nature, to touch, to smell, to taste, and to encourage others to do the same. That is the big difference. And here we have some Boy Scouts here that were touching and smelling and tasting, and they said it was the best they ever had, and it was a 14-year-old talking to them. It was great. So, on to the zoo teen experience today. This is where you see how we broke it down to give them the best opportunity. The first year is their foundation year. This is where all of the hard work is done for a teen. They come in, and they get the CIG basics, not the entire training, but the interpretive aspect of it, where they learn what is interpretation and how can you do it on a simple level playing field. No matter how long a teen is with us, they are required to be interpreters for a minimum of 12 hours each month, except during summer. After attending orientation and a one-on-one interview, the teens that are chosen attend a mandatory 4-day training that spans over 2 weekends. During that time, they learn guest services, safety, basic interpretive skills, and job-specific skills. Each teen is required to certify by doing a 10-minute presentation on the first Saturday of the very next month. During the interim of that, they are able to do one-on-one mentoring with a zoo teen who's already been through the process. If they want to, they can do it with multiple teens to get multiple skill sets because everyone learns differently. They spend the next year working on those topics that they've learned, making them very, very, very great, and then they're able to choose new topics. So if I'm learning about the Kaweah and I feel like I've got it down, then I can learn about the Chuckwalla, or I can learn about the endangered species. So that brings us to year two. Come on. Year two, the kids come back, but they're only allowed to come back if they're invited. Why? Because we want those kids that come back to be those that showed a desire to grow, to lead, and to succeed. Because year two starts leadership. You can't enter into leadership unless you've already done a year. For the next 2 to 4 years, they're given the opportunity to attend multiple trainings, mentor training, animal handling training, and also to be nominated for the leadership committee. The leadership committee has a president, a vice president, a treasurer, a certification overseer, and special events scheduler, and two assistants for them. That is what most of the teens reach for, is to be on that committee. And it's been very successful. In this role, the teens are able to learn the importance of organization, punctuation, and leadership. I forgot about those pictures. In the third and fourth year, the zoo teens continue to learn and grow. Depending on their focus, they can take on new interpretive locations, backpacks, or cart locations. They can learn and handle every animal that we have available to them, with at least 19 carts, 12 backpack chats, and at least as many animals for them to handle, the kids have a lot to keep themselves busy and growing. We also offer them professional certifications through the National Association of Interpretation, which is the Certified Interpretive Guide Training and the Certified Interpretive Host Training, which me and almost all of the people in the Education Department are certified as trainers so that it can be offered no matter who comes or goes. They can also do Project Wet and Project Wild. And we do educational field trips, like we've gone with Miss Carolyn Conway here to the wetlands. Where did we go? We went to the
Mission Creek
and the Pioneer Town. And Pioneer Town. It's fun. So the next slide is very special. It's the last one. And it's actually what a zoo teen is today from the perspective of a zoo teen, our president and our certification assistant. Sorry, I'm going fast. Today's zoo teen, and this is Katie Mahone. She's our zoo teen president, and this is what she says. To me, being a zoo teen is someone who is not only passionate about animals, but someone who has the will and initiative to educate the people around in a way that makes an impact. This means we reached her, because had we not given her the leadership, training, and everything, she would just think that she was there to volunteer. She cares, and you can tell in her answer. This is Colin Turner. He's our zoo teen certification assistant. And he says, a zoo teen is an interpreter for desert conservation and educational guides to the public. Zoo teens leave guests with a better understanding of the environment and a passion to help preserve the environment for future generations. In those statements, we know we've done a good job. Thank you.
Thanks, Romina. So how many of you had heard about the zoo teen program down at the Living Desert before, by a show of hands? Okay, great. So thank you very much, Romina, for telling us about the zoo teen program. There's a lot of avenues into getting education about the outdoors, and certainly the Living Desert is a major institution in our area for doing that kind of work. And we really appreciate you telling us about that program. I wanted to plug, while we're in between speakers here, the next two Black Rock Lecture Series events. One is on April 17th, and it's climate change response. There's going to be some great panelists, including Dr. Cameron Barrows and Ian James at the Desert Sun, plus some resource staff from Joshua Tree National Park. And then May 15th is the final lecture in the Black Rock Lecture Series for the year, for this year until the fall. And it's putting it all together, which is achievable action items. And it's our very own David Smith, the new superintendent at Joshua Tree, April Saul at the Wildlands Conservancy, and Dr. William McDonald from University of California at Riverside. These cards that have the last two Black Rock Lecture Series are available over here on the table, right by the National Park Service folks there. I've known our next speaker for many years. It's been my great pleasure to work with her very closely at the Pioneertown Mountains Preserve, at the Mission Creek Preserve, and at the Whitewater Preserve. And it's a real pleasure to get to introduce Caroline Conway. She's been the education director for the Wildlands Conservancy's Desert Preserves for just about 10 years now. The time has gone by very fast. Formerly, Caroline was an education director at the Living Desert, and she's been teaching desert ecology to students and volunteers for over 25 years. Caroline has a master's in environmental education and serves as an adjunct instructor at the College of the Desert, where she teaches conservation of natural resources. She's a founding member of both the Natural Science Collaborative of the Desert Region and the Environmental Education Collaborative of Riverside and San Bernardino Counties, and is on the Natural Science Advisory Council for College of the Desert. So please give a warm welcome to Caroline Conway.
Okay, you're going to have to bear with me. I have a little bit of a cold. I will do the best I can with this voice. The Wildlands Conservancy is a nonprofit organization. It owns and operates a preserve system that has 12 beautiful landscapes throughout California. We purchase and restore these landscapes and open them to the public free of charge. We also provide outdoor education as part of our mission. And that's free outdoor education at all of our preserves. At our preserves right now, we reach about 25,000 kids a year. But the Wildlands Conservancy, largely unsung, has been contributing to outdoor education for LA County and Orange County students at outdoor schools and science camps for years. So they've reached literally hundreds and hundreds of thousands of children over the years with outdoor education. The places are pretty spectacular, so I wanted to show you some of them. This is Whitewater, which Fraser knows well. And that's not, you know, the canyon. Our preserves are actually places where you're at the edge of what we call the backcountry. You can go to those preserves and step out and within a mile be back on the Pacific Crest Trail or way back where nobody goes. And we feel a responsibility to prepare people for that. We'd like to encourage more people to take that step into the backcountry. That's Whitewater, and that's Whitewater's pond. And that's Whitewater down canyon. I couldn't resist that one. That's where the San Andreas Fault goes right by the canyon and opens up a huge divot in the land to the west. And that's where the water gets dammed. This is Mission Creek. This is where the Sonoran and the Mojave Deserts meet. One thing about our desert preserves, and they're what I'm going to focus on tonight, is that they're all three watersheds. So obviously, my focus in education is watershed ecology. I can't pass that up. I'm in the desert, and we've got water. So that's, yeah, that's what our main focus is. Yeah, it looks better now. So you're looking west, and you're looking from our gate back to Mount San Gorgonio. And at Mission Creek, we introduce students from Desert Hot Springs to their watershed because the water that comes down from Mission Creek on the backside of Gorgonio is what contributes to their drinking water. This is right at the gate where the Dude Ranch is. And this is the two canyons together to show you how close they are. So there's a really nice walk between the two canyons. This is Whitewater going up to Gorgonio, Mission Creek, and you can walk between them. So another topic that we cover educationally is the idea of ecological corridors or wildlife corridors. These are places where ecological processes and wildlife themselves are moving, and they're moving between areas with populations of animals like themselves, or they're moving to places that are even larger like the park. So our preserves are strategic that way. They link open spaces to one another, and we try to bring that into our educational programs. This is Pioneertown Mountains Preserve, and this was, I have to admit, before the fire. I see April out there, and she's noticing that we've got old growth forest there, but it looks very good now. Some of that forest will never come back, but a lot of it has. We had only 1 year of school programs at Pioneer Town, or one formal year, before we had the fire. So there, our strategy has been different, and we're not bringing out as many kids, except for Cindy's class, and she'll tell you about that. That's the North Canyon when we've got a little bit of water in it. And this is Oak Glen. So we have two preserves that have been doing outdoor education longer than our desert preserves, and Oak Glen is one. And Wind Wolves, our largest preserve that Cindy might also mention, is the oldest. And that, between the two of those and ours, again, we're reaching about 25,000. There's a lot of kids who have passed through those education programs. In fact, Wind Wolves for many years was just doing education programs. It wasn't even open to the public.
Where is that at?
It's south of north of Bakersfield on the Maricopa Highway. It links the Carrizo Plain all the way over to the Tejon Ranch. It's a huge wildlife corridor. And that preserve has elk, herds of elk. Elk where when they run past, you can hear their hooves thundering. I mean, it feels like you're in California many, many years ago. It has antelope, large populations of animals. So I wanted to talk a little bit about how we're doing it. We have paid staff, but we have always paired our paid staff with volunteers. And some of those volunteers are in this room. I like introducing children to people that are as old as their grandparents, because they don't have that all the time, and because those people are the people with time and energy to give those students something that they don't get all the time. So we definitely rely on our docent partners and our other volunteers, and we're very grateful for that. So we do a mix of both staff and paid volunteers. We do, as all programs do, science standards-based programs. That's especially important nowadays because teachers don't even get off the campus unless they can go to the principal and show what standards we're going to be teaching. I have teachers tell me all the time I'm their only science education that year, which is a very frightening thought. So that's what our focus is on. Back in the old days when I was at Living Desert, they used to come for Native American programs and other subjects. But nowadays, to get out of school, they're probably going to do the subject they do the least in school. And that, unfortunately, is still science. With next generation science standards, that's improved. The science standards themselves have improved. The emphasis on science has improved. Common Core helped pave that passageway. And now students are once again asking tough questions that have no right and wrong answers and thinking more about how natural processes work. But for now, most of our programs are science-based. However, that said, the teachers and I know that when those students are coming, it might be the only time that year they're getting outside. And we really want to foster that connection. So I feel like it's a knife edge of the focus that's intellectual and the five senses and the heart. And we try to bring them both together. Most of the time, it's not hard, believe it or not. The kind of ecological concepts we have to teach are the most basic ones. Really, I'm in it for three. I mean, honestly, between them all, the ones I focus on are interdependence, change, diversity. I feel like if they can understand those, and they're all understandable in social terms, relationships, change, which humans don't like as much as nature is always doing it, and diversity, difference. Those are important. Now, can I stretch those into NGSS science standards? Easily. That part's a breeze, because they work for it. But believe it or not, the level of ecological literacy out there among young students is really down about as low as their number of times they're going outside. And so I am going to talk about the challenges tonight, because I've seen it over these 25 years. I've seen big changes. And I think they're important for the community to pay attention to, because I happen to believe that environmental education, or let's put it this way, ecological literacy is a community problem. It's a community need. These are people who are voting. These are people who have children. I also teach at a college. And most of those students don't know where their water comes from. Even though I swore I taught that, they don't know. By the time they get to college, they've forgotten. They don't know where their trash goes. And they're already parents. And so the course that I teach is for the people that Cindy probably doesn't get. It's the people who didn't gravitate to the sciences. It's the kid who isn't really out in front of my group going, oh, what else is that? They're the one in the back who's basically fingering the iPad or whatever, waiting for the preserve, you know, trip maybe to be over. They're not that engaged. They have to take a science, though. And in this science course, we give them a crash course in ecology and then the science behind the largest environmental problems that we're facing. Things like food distribution, energy production, climate change, water shortage, those kinds of things. And at the end of that class, a lot of times they'll come up to me and say, why wasn't I taught this? Well, one of the reasons is we spend 5 cents per child on environmental education in this state. Another is that all of us, everybody in this room, is working very hard to introduce children to nature and to make sure they get science education. But we're still, with nonprofit programs and even government programs, probably only getting to about 15% of them. We tried to do a survey for the collaborative we've started between the two counties to see if we're reaching a lot of kids. And we're probably not as effective as we could be. So these are big challenges. And here's some of the things I've noticed. Actually, I should be forwarding the nice slides of all people. Oh, there's Fraser. He's not a docent, but I slipped him in there. And there's the pond at Whitewater. And there we are in front of a creosote. I actually was getting ready to come here and realized I had creosote branches in my hair from climbing under there with sixth graders today. Here's the thing. We're very, very lucky. We have docents. We have great partners. In fact, we work with the park. We're going to be, hopefully, your citizen science climate change project. We'll actually have two sites at our preserves. We'll be able to use that for high school students like Cindy's students. We have funders who actually help us with one of the biggest challenges, which is transportation. Because schools, even though we offer free programs, they can't find the money for the buses. And there is an interest in helping organizations like ours do the work we do. But there are, it seems like the job gets bigger every year. We're now two generations out. The parents, the chaperones, as well as the kids, have not spent much time out in nature. And it's clear and present. I can tell. Here are the things I notice. First of all, no kid anymore wants to sit on the ground. I just can't stand that. They will not sit. I have to finally tell them they can crouch. And they'll crouch, and then maybe when they get really tired, their legs give out, they'll sit. I don't know what it is. They're afraid of ants. I have kids that stand on the bus. They will not come down and say, are there snakes here? And I say, of course there's snakes here. I can't come. My mother told me I can't go anywhere where there are snakes. I mean, they're afraid. They're afraid of a lot. Mostly they're afraid of things that aren't there. Animals, they've, you know, pythons that are out to get them. That kind of thing. But there's a lot of fears we have to address. And then there's some kids who are absolutely delighted, and they tumble out of the bus and practically fall over because there's not a lot of gym happening in schools anymore, and they're not quite as coordinated as they used to be. We take them off trail, and we have to spend a, I have to work them up to that because they're tripping all over themselves. And I don't mean for a minute to imply that there's some change in them. There isn't. They're just as wonderful as kids have always been. They're just as eager to learn, and they're just as easy to teach. But they don't have as much experience outside. And so we spend 15 minutes, 10 minutes waking up each sense because they haven't been paying attention with those. They've been paying attention to this. We let them know that it's okay if they don't know the answer to something. that this is something new for them, and that they'll get better at it as we go along. And finally, and this is my most important thing, and I do it with every program, and I think all my docents do it too, we have 3 minutes of silence out there. By that time, hopefully they're sitting. Whether they spend about 5 minutes finding the perfect rock to sit on, but they'll finally sit. And here's what you find out after they sit. I'll ask, so, anybody doing that at home anymore? Most of them are not, but a couple say yes, they have. I say, so what do you notice when you sit outside? And this is what kills me. I've had a girl say, it's the only time that there's quiet. And I say, well, where do you go? And she goes, oh, I don't go outside, I go under the bed. I have kids telling me all the time that it's the only time they feel less stress. They're completely stressed out. In fact, now I just say, it really relaxes the stress levels, doesn't it? And they all know what I mean, whether they're third graders or sixth graders, because their lives are already full of stress. So I guess what I'm trying to say is there's lots of organizations out there doing good work. There's lots of kids who are right there and excited about this work and are going to be showing up, but there's lots of kids we're not reaching. So I think our nonprofits and our government agencies have to network as well as we can. We know that everything works by strong and healthy networks. And whether it's a collaborative at our local level, like the NSCDR, or whether it's a collaborative of two counties, we have to work together, find out what niches our organizational programs are filling, what's not happening, who's being left out. We have to lobby in Congress for more than 5 cents to be paid for environmental education. And we have to make sure that communities join us in this important effort. Because, as I said earlier, I think this is a social problem, and it will only be solved if we approach it as a community problem. Thanks.
So thanks very much again, Caroline. It's always good to hear you speak. I think Caroline could probably run for office based on some of the things that she's saying. And we'd all be refreshed. We'd all be ready to go. I wanted to take a second to remind everybody that Big Morongo Canyon Preserve has got amazing wildflowers right now. So if you haven't been there lately, get down to see Big Morongo right now. It's pretty amazing. It's really, really a sight. And Mission Creek. Don't worry, April, I wouldn't forget. And Mission Creek as well. We just had some pictures of tortoises covered with with wildflowers all over their mouths show up on Twitter today. Again, it's another great pleasure of mine to introduce our next speaker. Cindy meant a lot personally in my life. She was one where I was kind of right at the tipping point in high school for where I was going to go with my life, and Cindy helped push me off the fence solidly to the green side of things. So Cindy has a bachelor's degree in biology with an emphasis on ecology and evolution from UC San Diego, and a master's degree in environmental education from Cal State San Bernardino. She has taught at Yucca Valley High School for the past 22 years. Her program, Field Ecology, has been the starting point for many students pursuing degrees and jobs in environmental fields over the past 18 years, one of which is me. I'd like to point out that when you drive by Yucca Valley High School, and you look over to the high school and you see a garden at Yucca Valley High School, Cindy was really the driving force to getting that garden installed at Yucca Valley. Having gone to Yucca Valley, I realized what an amazing job and task it was, not only to teach there, but also to inspire the administration there and do great things like getting the garden installed there. So with that, please welcome Cindy Zaks.
There's a couple slides I have to read, so that's why. So I wanted to thank Frazier, that was super sweet, Frazier, and the Desert Institute for having me here tonight. I know the Institute does an amazing job working with people of all ages and getting them outside. So I wanted to share with you tonight a little bit about my ecology program and some of my philosophy of what I try and do with the kids and why, and then some of the successes and inspirations that they give back to me. So when I was first thinking about putting this program together, I realized that the park stewardship theme was very similar to a theme that my daughter spoke on 4 years ago when the Western Governors Association was here. Probably some of you went to that. And so I looked back at her speech for a little bit of inspiration, and I found some really interesting quotes that I thought would be a good start for this particular program. So I just wanted to share with you a couple quotes from her essay. So this is my daughter speaking. She says, It is in the national park where I learned to walk, ride a bike, rock climb, ride a horse. I learned to trust myself, jumping between rocks. I learned trail and backcountry manners. I had my first job in the park and learned responsibility and care for others. I was exposed to wilderness because my parents are comfortable in natural places and made sure I was introduced to nature from infancy. And that first picture was her, by the way, also the little bitty one. That's her a little bigger. And she continues and she said, sadly, many kids and teens today don't have the opportunity I've had. Their parents are too busy, too impoverished, or too uncomfortable themselves in natural places. We don't share with our children that with which we are unfamiliar. As a result, we have an epidemic of what Richard Louv in his book Last Child in the Woods calls nature deficit disorder. And I think this is a lot of what Caroline was talking about too, that kids are just not comfortable because their parents aren't comfortable. So we have to get our kids out there. And this is the last part of her speech. I know it's kind of long, but I wanted to share it with you. She said, as a result, we need to find a way to provide teens with outdoor experiences to be a surrogate parent, if you will, for kids who don't have parents who are able or willing to take them to parks. Throughout my life, I've watched this type of surrogacy change students' lives through my mother's ecology class. The question we have to ask is what makes these trips so pivotal in the lives of our students? It's security and relationships. Feeling safe emotionally and physically allows teens to open their minds to new experiences and to the beauty around them. This is what parks need in order to encourage teen involvement. So when I was thinking about all of this, I also remembered this quote that I was exposed to recently that I thought was really interesting because it segues into what Caroline said so perfectly, and I thought this was the most beautiful quote. It's from a nature philosopher by the name of Vladimir Nabokov, if that's how you pronounce it. He said, "There is a high ridge where the mountainside of scientific knowledge joins the opposite slope of artistic imagination, where precision of poetry and the art of science can meet." And I just loved that quote. I actually have to tell you, my daughter sent that to me. And it's just beautiful. So I thought, well, what are the challenges with kids? And I didn't want to forget how I worded this, so this is the last words, I promise. So our challenge, the challenge of parks, is to figure out how to create that high ridge for students, how to teach natural history in an imaginative, artistic way, a way that presents science as a form of poetry from the heart. It's hard to ignore the cries of those we love. It's even harder to ignore the cries of places we've grown to love. Take kids to wild places, then just get out of the way. Be their support, be their safety, be their coach, but get out of their way and let them develop the relationships. So this is what I try to do with my ecology class. And in the idea of starting sort of safe and secure, we started our school's garden that Fraser mentioned. If you do drive down Onaga past the backside of the high school, you see a 40 meter long mural that says Grow Organic that the kids designed and painted themselves a number of years ago. So this garden, when we talk about community involvement, this garden was built from donations from our community and some donations, materials and such from the school district. This is about a $15,000 garden. The MBCA helped sponsor the garden. Wildlands provided some materials. All over the community gave donations for this garden. So the students get their own bed. They go out once a week. They get to grow whatever they want to grow. They get to take it home. They can share it with their parents. It is the most fun time. We're out there just enjoying each other, talking to each other. The kids are talking to each other, developing a community. I get to start hearing stories. We're all putting a community together. I think it's one of the most amazing things to watch a bunch of teenagers run around a garden with pure abject joy, trying to figure out whose carrot is bigger. And you know, they grow different things, and then they'll say, oh, well, have you ever tried a turnip? I haven't tried a turnip. Well, here, I grew this great turnip. Try this turnip. Well, my radish is bigger than your radish. Look at all these radishes I have. Do you want some radishes? So they're sharing all of these things all the time. And in the meantime, they're learning. They don't always necessarily realize they're learning. They're learning about the insects. They're learning about the soil. They're learning about where food grows from. They're learning what broccoli looks like when it grows and goes to seed. I had no idea that's what a broccoli looked like. It's an amazing thing. So it's a really beautiful experience. They also learn maintenance. So they have to take care of their garden. They have to hula hoe the whole garden. They have to do repairs. They have to weed their own beds. They have to take care of the whole place while they're there. So this is one of our beginning places. It's at school. It's during school hours, so it's convenient. It's you know, a controlled situation. It's right there. It's simple, but it's meaningful. So I do also want to talk about partnerships. This kind of program, which you'll see involves a lot, there's no way this program could exist in isolation. There's community involvement in a lot of different aspects, but one of the biggest community partnerships we have is with the Wildlands Conservancy, that Caroline's here representing tonight. They do a lot of financial support of our class, and we provide labor. So one of the major things we do is habitat restoration work. We go up 4 times a year, and we do restoration projects. One of the things we have done a lot of over the last 15 years is restoration of illegal off-road vehicle roads. So this is not something Wildlands wants, is off-road vehicle roads. When there's scars there, it invites more off-roaders to ride up those scars and make them worse. So what we do is we go in, and we do what's called vertical mulching, kind of a technical term. The kids learn all about what that means. And we go around, collect debris, down materials, and we bring it in, and we start essentially planting it and disguising the road until in the end, you virtually can't tell that there was a road there. By doing that, that helps to dissuade off-roaders because, you know, if they even notice that there was a road there, they're probably not going to run over it again. So we've done this a lot. Probably, I don't know, 10, 12, 13 years worth of kids have been doing restoration work. It was really sad when a lot of our work burned in the fire a few years ago. But we also do trail work. So they're building a river crossing. And one of the things that happens on these days is they're building their community. So as a group, they're getting closer and closer. And they're getting closer with me, and I'm getting closer with them. I have heard so many stories, personal stories, tragic stories, but also happy stories. I listen to stories about, you know, my boyfriend did this, and my girlfriend did that, and what should I do, Ms. Zax? I don't know what to do, and I got in a fight with my parents last night, and I don't know what to do, what should we do? And this is what happens while we're working. But, you know, they're working, they're outside, their defenses are down. Sorry, guys. And they're willing to talk. So it's a really wonderful time for me to start mentoring them and for the rangers and people who are there and working with us are mentoring them as well. We go on camping trips every year. We go on 3. We start out simple. This is Joshua Tree National Park. We just go out for one night, usually in September or October. And for a number of kids, it's their first camping trip. I've had kids, it's the first time they ever slept in a sleeping bag. It's amazing. I don't treat them any different. I don't sit there and go, are you okay? Are you going to, you know, I just throw them out there. Let them do it, okay? I have a few rules. You know, there's normal safety rules, but there's also, and there's the, you know, okay, the boys can't go in the girls' tent, the girls can't go in the boys' tent, back and forth, that's all normal. But there's a couple other rules that I just want to touch on. One of them I call no rescuing. So they all go out, they set up their tents. Some of them have never set up tents. And they're working on setting up their tents, and they're having trouble. Now, I don't want to be stereotypical. My kids all know that I do not treat my girls any different than my boys. But I will say that more often than not, if someone's having trouble setting up tents, it's probably the girls. So then the boys, because they want to be nice, chivalrous, helpful, whatever, they want to go run over and help the girls. And I go, you're not going to rescue them. They got to figure it out for themselves. So they figure it out, or they don't. If they don't, we all get our chairs, we drag them over, we put a little semicircle around their tent, and we all sit there and laugh at them. Till they finish. It's good-natured laughing, it's building community, and then, you know, if it really takes too long, then I might start giving them some hints. But, it's funny, and then it's something we can talk about the rest of the time. The other rule I have, and I have a couple of my kids here sat in for a impromptu photo op for me this week because I needed a cell phone picture. So the other one is no cell phones and no electronics. Okay, we all know teenagers. They are attached at the hip to their cell phones. This is one of the most fun things ever, is taking all their cell phones away. I just walk along the front and give them a pillowcase and say, put them in the pillowcase. And then I make a big show of tying it up and going and putting it in my car. And they're bereft. Like, what am I going to do without my phone for 24 hours or 3 days? This is the greatest thing ever. Even more, their parents. The kids will say, well, my parents want to know how they can get a hold of me. They can't. You know, so this is independence building for the kids, but it's also independence building for the parents. Because these guys are juniors and seniors in high school. They're going to college soon. Their parents better get used to not hearing from them all the time. So this is a good opportunity to start. So we take all their phones away, and then this amazing thing happens. They talk to each other. They play with each other. They go play frisbee. They sit around the fire. They tell stories. They do all kinds of things. And you know what? They don't miss their electronics. And when they get them back 3 days later, some of them go, I don't even know if I want my cell phone back. This has been the nicest thing. This has been so peaceful, like Caroline said. It's been peaceful. It's been non-stressful. I don't have to worry about the drama going on at home or the drama going on back with my friends. This was the best thing ever, and they love it. Most of the time. So continuing with part of our camping trips and our association with Wildlands, one of the places we go during the year that's really one of the highlights is that Wind Wolves Preserve that Caroline showed you some pictures of. This is south of Bakersfield, north of the Grapevine, and west of the Tejon Ranch. It's a 100,000-acre private preserve, and we still get a private tour every year. I think we might be one of two or three school groups who still gets that kind of treatment. And the reason we get that a treatment is because of April and Fraser and everybody else who works for Wildlands from my program. So I'm kind of lucky to still get special treatment, which makes me really excited. So this is the Wildlands mission, to preserve the beauty and diversity of the earth and provide programs so that children may know the wonder and joy of nature. So we go out, we drive out, it takes about 5 hours on a Friday, and Saturday we go out on an all-day tour. We get to go out with the preserve manager or one of the naturalists, and they treat us like gold. They spend all day, they show us amazing stuff. One of the things I want to mention with this slide is the association we have with professionals in the field. Here we have a naturalist that's out with us all day, but we also have Joshua Tree National Park staff that come in and speak to us. We have people from all over the community that are working in environmental fields come talk to the kids. And one of the things that I do every single time we have a new person talk to the kids is I say, please tell them your job description, your educational background, and then trace the path from school to the job that you have. That way, by the end of the year, they've been exposed to so many different potential careers and pathways. And this is priceless because they're juniors and seniors in high school. They are deciding what they want to do with their lives. And if I can kind of push them off the fence onto the green side, then, you know, that's a win. So that's one of the things we do. And then because of this, there's a lot of kids who decide to pursue degrees in environment-related fields. I got one right here tonight who just right before the program got word she got accepted to UCLA for ecology, behavior, and evolution. She might choose a different school, but pretty exciting. We were both tearing up. So this is out on the preserve, and our naturalist here is actually pointing out a red-tailed hawk nest and a rock art site, Native American rock art site, which is pretty neat. They also learn all sorts of field equipment while we're out there. They're using spotting scopes, binoculars, they have field guides, they're using all different kinds of things. Early on, when the elk were released, they had radio collars, so we would track them and they would learn how to radio track the animals. All the batteries have now died on the elk, so we can't do that anymore. But we're still able to find the elk, which is right up there in the middle, a little hard to see, but there's a herd of elk up there. And they're beautiful and they're amazing, and the kids love seeing them because they don't get to see elk. So this was an amazing success story that Wildlands has. And while we're out, they're learning the animals, they're learning the plants, they're learning other natural history, they're learning Native American history, they're learning all kinds of stuff. But one of the things that I don't do is I don't make them take notes. There's a lot of reasons for doing natural history excursions where people take a lot of notes, but that's not my focus. I've always said, you know, don't tell anybody, but if they come at the end of the year knowing science, that's great, but what I really want to do is push them over the edge. So having them take notes all day is not touching their hearts. They're out, they're having fun, they're seeing beautiful things, they're learning all kinds of stuff. Sometimes they don't even realize they're learning it, but they are. And they're running around together and we're having a great time. So I don't focus on that during. I focus on the experience and the connection and building that passion. This is a group, this is an old slide, a bunch of kids, but you can see in the background some really neat Native American rock art. And you can see they're kind of joking around and having fun with each other. So this is one of the things that happens on the trips is they get really close. When we come back, that's when they do some journaling. I send them out on a 45-minute to an hour-long solo. I walk them down this road and I spread them all out so they can't talk to each other, right? And I say, please write on two things. Tell me 5 or 6 things that you learned today about natural history. Tell me what they were, what you learned, and why you picked that item. And then tell me what you would feel like if this preserve was destroyed. Because the Wind Wolves Preserve, prior to Wildlands acquisition, was slated to become a city called Newtown that would have rivaled Orange County. I always have the naturalists tell the kids that story of what almost happened. And I'll tell you, they feel it. And they write about it, and then they come back and we share. And it's a very emotional time. So this is when you start really seeing the heart and the passion. And they just say, I can't believe anybody would ever do this. This is the most amazing thing. This is incredible. How could anyone do this? And they're starting to really connect. So if they connect here, then it's not really a big step for them to connect other places as well that they maybe have never seen, because they're starting to understand that there's value in wilderness, whether they've been there or not. The last trip of the year is a backpacking trip. We go up to San Jacinto, so we take the tram up, hike in, spend the night, and then we do the peak the next day. We've been doing this for about 15 years, and we've taken a lot of different kinds of kids up this trail. We've taken kids with physical fitness issues. I had a kid with a horrible fear of heights. She was cowered on the floor of the tram all the way up. And then hiking up to the peak, about every 100 yards, she would collapse to the trail on the ground, and we'd have to get her back up and make her keep walking. But in 15 years, we have never not gotten a kid to the peak. And then they're so proud of what they've done. And we tell them, you know, now whenever you drive on Highway 10, all you got to do is look up and think, I was there. And think of the amount of confidence that builds and security and knowledge that builds. It's an amazing thing. So we just have a couple pictures. Oh, and I have also, we take parent chaperones only that are experienced in the backcountry. that really add to our experiences. So April's dad, Danny, is on the right, and he has been one of my main two chaperones, his wife Claudia being the other one, for about 15 years. They have added so much entertainment and support, and I just have a couple mentions of them later on too. This is just hiking. At the end, I just threw this in because this is funny. This was my husband's idea. He's over here on the side. You know, those of you who have been to the tram know that that walkway to get back up to the tram is horrendous. And it can take teenagers like half an hour to get up that thing. So he came up with the brilliant idea of just having some really silly little prize. And then we hold them all at the bottom of the trail, and then when we say go, they all have to race. And whoever gets there first gets the silly little prize, and believe me, it's usually a really dumb prize. And usually something one of us just has in our pack. But they actually really do race, and I was disappointed because I had about a 2-second clip of them racing that would have been really funny to have shown, but it was too short. The last project of the year, we go up to Wildlands, to the Pioneertown Mountains Preserve, and my kids meet up with a kindergarten class from Landers Elementary, taught by Beth Farr. My kids in groups plan a 45-minute ecological lesson on an ecology concept of their choice. They have to make visuals, they have to make an entire lesson plan, they have to have games, and it all has to tie together to teach the lesson. So there's typically three groups of teenagers, and the little kids rotate through so they get three different concepts and lessons. We spend about 2.5 weeks putting this together beforehand, and one of the fun things is when they do their dress rehearsals, all the other kids in the class have to pretend like they're kindergartners, and I try and tell them, doing this with your classmates as the kindergartners is going to be a whole lot harder than the real kindergartners, and it is. But this is such a neat project, and one of the amazing things today is I've had one or two students now in my class as juniors and seniors in high school who were the kindergartners years and years and years ago. I've had parents be the chaperones who have brought their children, and they're the chaperones for the kindergartners who were in my class and did this. So it's coming full circle. We've been doing this for a long time. One group made little matching t-shirts, so obviously they were doing desert adaptation. They take them on little hikes around, show them actually in the field. They play games. The last part of the partnership that I want to mention is the scholarships that Wildlands gives to us every year. I would estimate over the last 20 years, I think Wildlands has given between $20,000 and $25,000 in scholarships to my students. It's usually one or two kids a year, $1,000 or $2,000 a year. Usually now it's $2,000. In the beginning it was $1,000, and those kids go on to pursue degrees in environment-related fields. So April was our very first scholarship recipient. Fraser was our third recipient, and there's a couple more graduating from college this year, and there's quite a few that are out in the field now, which is pretty neat. This was a really cool full circle experience because this is Fraser 2 years ago awarding the scholarship to my daughter, who is now at UC Santa Cruz studying biology. What did I just do?
I don't know.
Fix it.
You keep talking, I'll fix it.
Okay. I pushed the middle button instead of one of the other buttons. So one of the things that I was asked to just mention briefly is, you know, how I inspire kids, but also how kids inspire me. How do you keep something like this going for 20 years? It requires a lot of energy. So you've got to have inspiration somewhere. So my kids are my inspiration. They're what keep it going. This is Zach Anaya. He graduated from Humboldt University a number of years ago, came back to Wildlands, and is now the preserve manager at the Jenner Preserve in Northern California. He is so excited to have this job. I think he's been there now a couple years full time. You might recognize April here in the lower right-hand corner. April also went to Humboldt University and got a degree in biology. She then came back to work for Wildlands. A lot of you, I think probably everyone in the room knows April, so you know about her Green Path North fight, that she spent 3 years keeping these horrendous power lines out of our community. And just as a really quick little thing to show you what happened on the day that this was announced.
Big victory today for a citizens group that spent the last 3 years fighting the Green Path power line that would have cut through Morongo Valley and Desert Hot Springs on its way to Los Angeles. KMIR6's Angela Monroe has more on today's announcement that ends this battle.
It was an emotional experience for April Saul, the conservation director who has fought the proposed power corridors.
The thought of an outside utility 100 miles away being able to condemn our preserve and our homes and the lands in our community was just really upsetting in this day and age.
The Los Angeles Department of Water and Power, DWP, proposed routes to carry geothermal, wind, and solar energy from Imperial County to LA. They announced they will withdraw their application.
We have submitted two letters to Bureau of Land Management and one to the U.S. Forest Service to withdraw the right-of-way grant application.
Big Morongo Canyon Preserves.
So, I mean, how could that not inspire you? April, you want to wave in case there's anyone in the room who doesn't know you? And then, you might recognize the guy in the middle here. So Frazier went to UC Santa Cruz, got his degree in biology, came back, worked for Wildlands. So he worked with April for a couple years and then got promoted down to preserve manager at Whitewater. During his tenure there, he went to a number of different preserves doing a little bit of consulting. This is, he's up at Jenner, actually, where Zach is now, with his wife, Jamie, who is also one of my graduates. And so I was super excited when they fell in love and got married. And now they're raising the second generation of little environmental stewards. Their little Lily's 8 weeks old and the cutest little thing. So he recently, about a year ago, left Wildlands to go to the Mojave Desert Land Trust, where he's now the conservation director. And this is him speaking at the event back last fall when Dianne Feinstein came to Whitewater to talk about her bill, the
California Desert Conservation and Recreation Act.
There we go. So that's him presenting there. So we've got both of these two, and I don't have Zach here because he's in Northern California. But April, I'm sorry, I don't have an embarrassing picture of you because all of them were too far away. And the only embarrassing one I had was you curled up on the side of the you know, road up in Covington Flats when our Raven survey. But I did find this. So if you don't recognize him, that's Frazier in the green t-shirt, showing off his guns. This is on the backpacking trip. There's a lot of stories that came out of this backpacking trip. I don't need to share any of them. they were quite a motley crew, these three. Garrett's up in Santa Barbara. He's doing a lot of neat stuff up there. Don't remember, is he still welding on the oil rigs? Yeah? Underwater welding. And Russ Root, who went everywhere with a black umbrella. So when we were in Wildlands, he was catching frogs in his umbrella turned upside down. So I'll never forget that. I think, you know, I have to throw this in. How could I not? So my daughter, that's my daughter, the little one, and when she was 4. This is actually in Zion, so it's a little out of context. But she's also a graduate of my program. And I get a lot of really neat letters back from her these days. She's actually a wilderness leader up there. So this is coming full circle. She takes students, UC Santa Cruz students, out on backcountry trips. She's teaching what she grew up with. I mean, she went with the kids on her very first trip when she was 5 years old. She went every year to Wind Wolves. She started going on the backpacking trip when she was 7. When she was seven on her first backpacking trip, she and my husband left an hour before the teenagers and they beat them to the peak. So maybe that was a precursor of things to come. She's leaving tomorrow morning to take 10 students climbing in Red Rocks into the Grand Canyon. So it's a pretty amazing stuff that she's doing, and you know, she's really carrying on everything that she's learned from both my husband and I over the years. This was a competition from her botany class to see who could find the only population of this plant on the UC Santa Cruz campus, so she was very excited to find it. And I just wanted to finish with a couple things. You know, again, Wildlands is our biggest partner, and you just can't do something like this without a partnership. As a school, we don't have the money for this. So Wildlands gives us the money to provide our transportation and substitutes for me when we go up there. But the Morongo Basin Conservation Association has been longtime supporters since the beginning. They give us monetary grants every year that help offset the cost of field trips, so that it doesn't cost us as much, so it doesn't cost the kids as much, and that's, you know, just been amazing over all these years. I do want to thank, I know they're not here, but most of you probably know Danny and Claudia, April's parents. This is the most beautiful picture of the three of you, by the way. They are responsible for introducing me to Wildlands 20 years ago. They said, hey, we've got this preserve. You should come up here and check it out. And by the way, you should make a whole class about this. And I was like a two-year teacher, and I think I was even pregnant at the time. And so they introduced me to Wildlands. They made that connection. They took us to Wind Wolves the very first time. April wasn't even in class. I think that was your, was that you guys the first year we went to Wind Wolves? And you know, they've been supporters all along for years and years and years, I think 15 years. They have chaperoned the backpacking trip. You know, I still remember when April's Humboldt, you know, softball team went to the College World Series for softball, and I didn't have any other chaperones, and Claudia opted to stay behind and chaperone my field trip and not go watch her daughter at the College World Series. I think I might feel guilty about that even still. But they have been amazing, amazing supporters. A lot of you know Doug Thompson and Robin Cabali, of course. And they've been big supporters over all the years. Robin has presented to the class quite a few times about native desert plants, both edible and medicinal. And she brings all the plants for the kids to try, and they think that's really exciting. And the last one I want to just mention is my husband, because I wouldn't be able to go on those backpacking trips every year. He's my wilderness medicine guy. He's my mountaineer. He's been all around the world, the Himalaya, the Eiger, all sorts of places. He's my security blanket on these trips. You know, I don't know that I would want to take 10 or 12 teenagers in the backcountry for 3 days by myself. Not that I'd worry about them doing anything bad, just if something was ever to happen. So he's my security blanket. He's also my pack mule. He's also the one when I'm freaking out 2 days ahead because I'm totally nervous about taking, you know, 28 teenagers to Wind Wolves. He's the one pulling everything out of the garage and packing it and putting my food together and just being my support all the time of everything that I ever try to do. So I had to put you in here, honey, because I wouldn't do it without him. I forgot to mention this earlier, just two other people, they're not here and I don't have pictures because it would have been a little awkward, but if Doug Weller and Carl Phillips with Morongo Unified School District did not support my class for the last 20 years, it would not be here. So Doug Weller protected it in the beginning when he was my principal, and you know, the powers that be were trying to squash this weird class, and then Mr. Phillips has protected it for the last 10 years. And I really owe a lot to them and to the fact that they've let me spread my wings and try all sorts of crazy things that I want to try and do, and nobody's ever told me no. So it's probably a good thing because it doesn't go over well when people tell me no. So that's the end of mine, and thank you to all of you guys.
Thank you very much, Cindy. So we've got about 10 or 15 minutes left, and this is the time when we'll do some question and answers for our panel. The way we'll do this is hand out these slips of papers. Please write your questions down on them. and we'll bring them up to me, and I will ask the questions directly to the panel. If you want somebody to answer specifically, just write their name on the question. One of the things I think that you can see as a theme is the ability for people that don't have the means, whether they're too young or don't know how to get out into the outdoors and have a relationship with the land. And so this is my opportunity to tell you to plug the Desert Institute's field classes that are offered all the time on a number of excellent topics that get everybody in the community out into the national park. And also to let you know that the National Park Association does a lot of things for the national park, but one of them is to fund buses and to fund staff to bring students out to the park. And just this year, the association contributed $62,500 to this end. That's pretty amazing. So let's have a round of applause. And if you're interested in that, getting students out to the park, whether you know students or want to support the program, you can see the folks over at the Joshua Tree National Park table. So with that, we'll start taking some questions. This is to any of our panelists. Other than federal and state governments, are there other funding sources for any of these kinds of programs? And the microphones on the table don't work. The little microphones that are flat do. So just talk and everybody will hear you, I promise.
I want to answer this because I forgot these partners. In Desert Hot Springs, there's a group called the Desert Hot Springs Groundwater Guardians, and they're part of a national organization, but they funded kids from DHS to come out and see their watershed for years and years, paid for all the transportation. We've gotten money from Southern California Edison. We've gotten money from the Anderson Foundation. We go for grants every year or we wouldn't be able to do it. And so there are funders out there.
I think the only other thing that I would add is like our greenhouse in our school garden was built with a grant from the California State. It was a garden grant, so it was money that was specially set aside for school gardens.
The Living Desert doesn't actually get any funding for the Zoo Team program. What we get right now is wonderful people like Carolyn Conway who take their time out to spend time with the kids and to speak at their meetings and to help to make them feel encouraged and see what's out there for themselves.
That's great. It sounds like a lot of partnerships. This question is for anybody on the panel. What is the optimal grade to introduce kids to nature given the funding and resource constraints?
I'll start with that one. I think we probably all would have different opinions based upon the age groups that we work with. I'm going to vote for the teenagers because to me they're far enough along in their maturity that they can actually recognize something that they really love, and they're at a point in their life when they're getting ready to separate from their parents and pursue what they love. So they're really at a wonderful cusp and maturity to be able to make those decisions for themselves. So that's my vote.
I'll put in a vote for kindergarten too. Whenever kindergarten comes, all of us, yes, we want them. I don't know. I don't think they're all great. All great.
I agree with Carolyn.
They're all great.
All great.
All right. Anybody on the panel? What do you feel the community, those of us in the room, can do to support and expand outdoor ed? And as a follow-up kind of expansion of that question, what can we do to support the principals and the administrative staff to allow schools to support outdoor education?
Well, the collaborative is one way. The two-county collaborative is open to citizens. It doesn't have to be educators. It can be anyone. We are hopefully inviting everybody who has a stake in ecological literacy in their community. So that's everyone. And that involves some meetings and some tasks. But I think when you support a school and you know that there's a program, that's always great support. And I also think parents who say, are my kids getting science ed? Are they getting outdoor ed? Are they getting environmental ed? Those kinds of questions are good questions to ask.
of teachers. Teachers will do their very best. They will bend over backwards when they're challenged.
I just wanted to add that the teens have a voice, and sometimes we look toward adults, but many times
coming from the teens, it's even more important. It's even heard stronger.
All right, thank you very much. So do any of the speakers have ideas about how their programs might work with this college, Copper Mountain College, seeing as the president, superintendent, and a biology professor are in the room?
I think there's a lot that you could do with a program, you know, for a college. I've often thought, gosh, you know, if I did this at a college, I wouldn't have to have permission slips and parent chaperones and buses, and it would free me up so much to do even so much more. So I think an ecology program with a lot of a field component, maybe a field lab component, would be an amazing alternative and an option for kids out here.
We do that at COD. All the lab classes for the class that I teach come to Whitewater, and we do a program on how the canyon is an ecological corridor. And that fits right with their curriculum, because I know what their curriculum is. So they've been coming for years as far as the lab class that's connected to that class. They also go to the sewer, which is a good field trip. They go a lot of places to have a sense of what happens with their water, their waste, and all of that.
My program is very focused toward teens, but I would say that once they get into college, they're still going to need something to reach for. I know when I was getting into college, if you didn't give me a bar to reach for, I'm the kind of person that would give myself a bar, but sometimes I did need that push. So I think that the fundamentals of the Zooteen program in raising that bar are very important, even in college.
That's great. Well, let's give our speakers a round of applause.
Scholarships for your students here at college.
Okay.
University of Southern California Edison, and lots of it. And so please encourage them to apply.
That's great. We're making connections right now.
If you're applying with CMC and sciences, let me know.
Very good. I also want to make sure and thank the college for hosting us. Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Cummings. And Joshua Tree National Park Association and Kevin and Meg for putting this on once a month. Join us on April 17th when we're going to talk about climate change.
Thank you.